Tell me who's that right? John the Revelator, who's that right? John the Revelator, who's that right? John the Revelator wrote the book of the seven seals.
The tradition of Kilkenny Tipperary is there. And Tipperary and Kilkenny meet, you know, form goes out the window. I love playing, I love being involved, I love training, I love being in with the lads. Certainly it gives you a great buzz, you know, to say you've achieved one of your dreams. For me, the hunger is when you win, like, you just want to do it again. I think when you love something you do, you want to do it for as long as you can. You have to have pride in that jersey and, I suppose, give it the respect that it deserves. Tipperary came and just hopped off us from the world go, and we were just ready for it.
Strange thing, I suppose, about Kilkenny Tipperary rivalry is, you know, when I was growing up, there was a serious Kilkenny Tipperary rivalry, and Kilkenny certainly never came out on the right side of it. The first time, I think, in 1967, when Kilkenny beat Tipperary, but it's the only time I can remember it happening, really. And then, during my own playing career, I never had the privilege of playing against Tipperary in Championship.
It had been so long since we got into final. 2001 had been the last time, and for you and me, that was a 7-year gap, and an 8-year gap, watching everybody else get to finals and feel that we should be there ourselves.
We would have all went to college with Tipperary lads, and you know, we would have heard the great stories of who was better, Kilkenny or Tipperary, and I think the real tradition of it came into it in that sense. I would have been very nervous before the match. I wouldn't normally be as nervous, but for this one, I can remember being especially nervous in the week leading up to the match.
The opening 10-15 minutes, I suppose we would have thought that that was the most important thing, to stay in the game. Yeah. I think Waterford and Limerick should have played Kilkenny in the years previous, was over after 20 minutes, because Kilkenny's game was get a few goals, blow the opposition away, and then just we'll make the rest of the game easy for ourselves.
It's the 121st All-Ireland Hurling Final, and this is the 125th year of the GAA. Kilkenny, as you know, going for that 4 in a row.
The All-Ireland itself, you know, we were going very well at the time, and we were going for 4 in a row, and Tipperary were kind of coming out of the unknown.
If I remember that from that 2009 final, it was definitely that it went so fast, and it was nearly a match was over before you realised that the game was on. So I think that 2009 final, especially the first few minutes, just went by in a blur.
To think that that went on for 70 minutes, it was just a huge intensity, but lucky enough we were ready for it, as were Tipperary, and it was all the way till the end. There was no way that any team was going to back off from each other. I remember after 14 minutes looking up at the clock, and I couldn't catch my breath, thinking, am I actually going to make sure the 70 minutes was that tough?
Both sets of backs let each set of forwards know that it was going to be a serious game. So I think the backs were totally on top, and it was very tense and tough. And I suppose it was, you know, what everyone for the outside world looking in at hurling would love it to be, and that's what it was, you know.
Getting it in now as far as Owen Kelly. After him is Jackie Tyrrell. Has the composure, has the accuracy, has that skill to put it over the bar. Lahr chasing after this one, taking it down that wing. They're all after him. Richie Powers after him. Can't get to him. Lahr strikes, and Lahr hits an absolute beauty. Out there is Horace. Owen Kelly under pressure. What a shot. What a point!
Tipperary probably got the better scores. Larry Corbett got some brilliant scores. Owen Kelly got some brilliant scores. So, and to be fair, because they were underdogs, the support levels were absolutely magnificent. But we, to be fair, I think what we did that day was we tipped along, we got a couple of scores, and I suppose we were probably, in one sense, happy to go in 2 points ahead, but we probably were a small disappointed with especially our forward play that we hadn't opened up a small bit more.
Diagonal ball across here, the one that caused problems, and it's going to cause problems again. What a very good save by Brendan Cummins. It was there for Henry Shefflin to take. Because they've done well. Out as far as Lark Corbett. Lark Corbett's got one already, and Lark Corbett's got a second.
Like, I think we always say we're going in at half time that we just say if you're up by 2 points or you're down by 2 points, there's really no difference. You still have a job to do in the second half, and it's very, very important for players not to get uptight about going into dressing half time. Just sit down and talk about what's after happening, and like, you know, you're looking to drive on for the second half.
Yeah, the intensity and the levels didn't drop essentially in the game. You know, it was competitive and in the balance right up to the very, very end. You know, both teams were supremely fit. As the game went on, I suppose substitutions became important as well, and they did play a serious part in it.
Kicked forward by Shane McGrath. In there towards Noel McGrath. They'll be hoping to get more from him or from Kerwick. Here's Kerwick's got a lot of pace. Cleverly playing it inside to Calnan. Goal chance!
Oh, save, a brilliant save.
What a save. Over the head of Noel McGrath. Coming to take it, here is Lark Corbett, 3 points in the first half, back in again, that's wide, it was a glorious chance, Owen Kelly.
It was saved again, Gerard, but really Owen Kelly, normally 9 times out of 10, that's in the back of the net, really Tipperary are leading Kilkenny in this game now.
Feeding it in towards Noel McGrath, could he yet be the star? Oh, that went off the stick of the goalkeeper and it's gone over the bar.
PJ was unbelievable, and he'd be the first man to tell you that he was unbelievable that day too. But no, look, he was sensational. He saved my bluff that day as well. You know, he was just I don't know. He was literally like a cat in the goal. There was nothing getting past him.
Even the one Owen slipped. Yeah. I mean, that was still the most awkward shot, I would have said, because a goal, you're all tense waiting for the hard shot, aren't you?
Yeah.
You know yourself, like, shame you hit a ball, like, and I had to watch it on the big screen to find out what happened with it, like, I was short as a goal.
Yeah, and, like, it's definitely, you know, we got a couple of goal opportunities, but PJ, as you say, played very, very well that day, and it just comes down to that they're the big saves and big games, like, that dictated the outcome.
There's no way we would have won that All-Ireland without him doing that, and for him to do that on the biggest day of all, it was just, I suppose, a great feat for himself, and I suppose he worked very hard to get where he did, and just to see him doing it then on the biggest day of all was just brilliant, and we were delighted for him, and I suppose we were delighted for ourselves as well that he did it.
Catches it really well, it flies through the air into the half forward. That was a wild swipe there, and the referee is going to take action.
The greatest of credit to Tommy Walsh, he's straight back up on his feet. I think a lot of other players would have stayed down, but it's still a red card, John.
It's a red card.
I don't think personally myself that it made much of an impact in the day. That, like, you know, we still got a couple of scores after that. The big decisions were probably just Martin Comfort coming on, getting the ball and getting the goal.
You go down to 14 men, it's probably never an advantage. But on the same token, I suppose, sometimes when you see a team going down by one man, to kind of get behind each other and really drives them on till the end of the game. But I think, I suppose, the real turning point in that was, I suppose, our two goals in the space of 3 minutes.
The sending off actually seemed to spur Tipperary on a bit more. We seemed to take our foot off the gas, and I remember their forwards, they only had 5 forwards, but the work they were doing was unbelievable. And I think Seamus Cannon got a score at one stage, and Shane McGrath got one right out the wing as well, and it looked like he was slipping away from us.
Oh, a slip by Conor O'Mahony. Here's an opportunity. Fed inside there, in for power, trying to get away from the attentions of a couple of players, one of them Paul Curran, and it's a penalty.
We probably needed a big score, because at that stage we were clinging by our fingernails, I think, to grasp onto him. So we needed some kind of a big score. To be fair, Martin broke onto a puck out, I think, and cut through the defence, and they were drawn to him, and he fed Richie, and Richie put the head down, and the whistle went, and we had the penalties.
I'd still be biased and say I think he was fouled outside, but the penalty, and while it was maybe, I suppose some would say, a game changer in it, like, we had enough chances
You know, we're only ourselves to blame, really. You know, we had enough chances on that day, outside of that penalty, you know, to put Kilkenny away.
I didn't fancy taking any man. I wouldn't say you did either, Tommy, but no, look, no better man than Henry to come up and hit it.
Henry, of course, being Henry, didn't look to the sideline for any guidance as to what he should do or anything like that, you know, and if he had looked... He wouldn't have got any guidance anyway, because I don't ever suggest what he should do with those penalties, or if it were a 21-yard free, chances are you would have gone for any of that.
Commons is ready. Shefflin is as well. He's got 8 points so far. They need it. It's in the back of the net. Henry Shefflin cracks in his 22nd ever championship goal.
There's one thing about Martin Comfort when he comes on. He has an eye for a goal and he wants a goal.
Back come the team looking for four in a row. Back comes Owen Larkin. 1 point so far. In for Coverburn. Two in a row. The game has turned around.
He was involved in the first goal and scored the second goal. And he was full of running that day. And, you know, I suppose Owen Larkin cut through. And I suppose the whole thing just opened up for Goethe. And it was a great pass, but a brilliant run into space. And it was a brilliant finish under Brendan.
Martin certainly that day made, was the difference, I think, between the two teams, you know, and when he came on, he knew pretty much where to run. He picked the channels between our half-back line and, just like you said, headed straight for the black spot, and we struggled with it.
I suppose we gave the next 12 months then, looking at him on the television for the Christmas period with the big fist up in the air, and he ran now past the 21.
And the substitute, Martin Comerford, scores in the 64th minute. Tommy Walsh has the ball. Kilkenny have the trophy. It's Kilkenny who are the All-Ireland champions for 2009.
I think losing 2009 final was the weirdest experience I've ever felt. I don't know about you, Larry.
You only get so many chances in any game, and you have to take a certain percentage of them chances. And if you don't take them, you're not going to win.
When the final whistle goes, it was just a brilliant, brilliant feeling. And you know, it's the feeling from January to the final whistle in September. You're dreaming about, and you're hoping will take place. So, and you know, you're just so thrilled.
We'd so much put into that final, and we'd lost, but yet everybody went. Everyone said, like, "Oh, geez, you should have won that one," you know, and that you really did win it. But sure, in reality, we hadn't. Yeah.
They are the first team to do four in a row since the 1940s.
You know, we've gone to four in a row, but obviously we beat Tipperary, which Kilkenny people going back through the years wouldn't have experienced much, especially going back to 91. So it was giving the people of Kilkenny an awful lot of satisfaction.
There's no point having excuses, and that's really what we were listening to were excuses. And I suppose we had to kind of battle it for 12 months.
But Brian Cody's team had character. They had key players in key areas. They had leaders all over the field.
It really looked like it was gone from his, I suppose, 10 or 15 minutes to go. But I suppose, as Brian said, you just stay plugging and plugging. And to do that in an All-Ireland final and then get the win, that's what I think gave us the most satisfaction.
You want that feeling to last forever. And the fact that we had beaten Tipperary added to that, because they are outstanding opponents and they had a superb team. Sheer sense of delight from everybody. It was a pleasure to be part of.
people were talking about the 2009. They were saying that this is going to be a bigger, better game, but for all we knew, it could have been, the game could have been a flap. We didn't know what to expect when we were going up. And I suppose what happens, I suppose we said already, matches in Crovac, they take a life of their own, and that's really what the game took, Brendan.
Yeah, it did, you know. I mean, coming into it, obviously Kilkenny had their injury worries and all, but that wasn't really our concern. I mean, for me anyway, I hoped all of Kilkenny would be fit, you know, and well, you know, not only from the fact that Henry and these lads were fantastic players and you want to see him play in the final, but as well as that you want to play the best possible team Kilkenny can put out.
There's a huge build-up to the five in a row, and I suppose anyone that was around Kilkenny at the time, especially with the injuries to Henry and Tenno, and there's just huge, huge talk about more so that side of things rather than the match itself.
I would say for certain that the supporters were very caught up in the whole, as it became known, the drive for five, and the media as well, obviously.
I mean, I heard about crowds, 16,000-17,000 over Washington training, like, and I was thinking to myself, God, I go up to Turles, like, and there'd be a couple of pigeons hanging off the top of the stand as much as watching us, like, wasn't it?
When you lose All Ireland, you look back and go, maybe they were a distraction, but at the time, what I didn't think it was, things were going, you know, well, training was going well. Obviously, we had the injuries and the question marks over Tenno and Henry, obviously.
It's a gloomy afternoon, but the setting is spectacular. The prize the biggest hurling has to offer on a uniquely Irish day, where there's the promise of craft and courage, quality and pace, thrills and excitement. And the crowds have gathered here from early morning. They've been coming here, indeed, all weekend to Dublin.
It was very similar to 09. It started at a whirlwind pace, and again, the atmosphere, and I think the Tipperary supporters were even louder this year.
I think we're probably a little bit more focused. I would think in 2010 we were in 09, we'd learned the lessons of 09. I think we probably blinked in 09, thinking that down the home straight, that when we went 3 or 4 up, maybe we had this thing. I think in 2010 it was more of a, we'll stay here till 10 o'clock tonight, but we're not going home without it, kind of an attitude, like, wasn't it?
We were 100% up for it, they were 100% up for it, and I suppose we just met head on, and we just said the best team win at the end of the day.
As Shane McGrath wins that, huge one down towards Lark Corbett, he's got it, he's scored! A goal by Lark Corbett! His 17th ever championship hurling, a crucial one here, coming after 10 minutes, and it's 1-3 to a point. It was a huge delivery. All of a sudden, Lark Corbett was one-on-one there. Beat his man, beat the goalkeeper, put it into the back of the net. And there you saw the fullback exposed big time by Lark Corbett.
They got the first goal, which was huge. You know, normally we hit early and we might get the scores and get on top of them, but they got the goal. They had a game plan and they executed it perfectly, you know.
It was a great ball in from Shane McGrath. I suppose it's a thing that he's done for the last number of years, just getting the ball into the full forward line. And that's one thing we would have always said, just get the ball into the full forward line and we'll see what happens.
I suppose, and you got one-on-one with Noel Hickey. I remember looking at it up on the screen, and you just slipped in behind him, like, and Noel had slipped, which was that little bit of luck, I suppose, that in 2009 we didn't have, you know. It was a great catch, and the finish was unbelievable and all that, like, you know. I mean, we got that little break, and of course, a bit like you came the year before, when you get the little break and you're ready and there's your moment in time, I suppose, like it was for you, you take it, don't you?
And that's exactly, we got the breaks, we got the bit of luck, and we can dress up the goals and we can dress them up anyway, but we just we got the bit of luck, and thank God we did, took our chances.
As Henry Shetland plays it in here towards DJ Reid, this could be a rapid response. Oh, what a stop by Brendan Cummins.
When Tipperary started so well, that was definitely, I suppose, a big disappointment. But we came back then, we brought it back to, I'd say it was 2 pints or a pint, and we thought maybe, you know, that's it. I suppose Tipperary, after doing all the hurling, and we were able to come back then to just within a pint or two. But I think, I suppose, it masked over, I suppose, the fact that we were being out hurled.
We're going to tip her all over to Kenny at the moment. There's Henry Shefflin, trouble is the... Shefflin is in difficulty as Shane McGrath plays it down. Is the gamble about to backfire?
Definitely gone, Gerard. How you think? You know, he pulled up straight away and took off his helmet. He's definitely gone.
Well, he's lasted just under 13 minutes.
Obviously, my whole day just fell to pieces then, so I suppose it was up to the bench for me and sit down and just see what went on, you know.
Obviously, Henry being Henry Shefflin, he was a huge loss, but, you know, in the backs of all our minds, he was after doing his cruciate
was he, you know, did we think he was going to make 70 minutes? Well, personally, I didn't think so. I knew he was probably going to get through some part of the game.
I think a sign of the respect between both teams, and to Shane McGrath, met him going across the field and just shook hands with him, and he got a standing ovation going off. And I think in hindsight we're all disappointed to see him leave, to be honest, because you don't want to see any player lose out an opportunity to play in the Ireland final.
No, and as exactly Brendan has said already, we wanted to play the best that Kilkenny had to offer.
But at the same time, and Henry knows this better than anyone, it's not about Henry on the day or in the build-up or anything else. Vital man, absolutely massive player for us, but it's about the team at all times, and you know, you get in somebody to take his place and the team goes ahead.
It was a loss for us, but in the grand scheme of things, I don't think it changed really. It wouldn't have changed the result.
Oh, and Larkin's raiding inside here to Power. Oh, what a goal! Richie Power gets his sixth ever in the championship, his first this afternoon.
Typical Richie, he turned on the sixpence and ended up in the back of the net. But it was, we really needed it, because at that time Tipperary not only were the 6 points up, but they were on top in an awful lot of sectors of the field.
And that's a goal and four for the man from Carrickshaw. 3 points the margin, 3 minutes to go to half time. And it started with Owen Larkin raiding. Look at the good run here. An intelligent run made by Richie Power, and a clinical finish to the back of the Tipperary net. It's some match. It's 110 to 17.
Made a fantastic run, actually, out around the back of Paul Curran. It was unbelievable the way he did it now, you know. Of course, he got his hand from 6-7 yards. He roofed it, and we'd been 5 or 6 up, I'd say, at that stage. And, you know, it was a little bit of a dent in the confidence. But I know when we went in at half-time and we were looking around in fellas' eyes, like, the focus was unbelievable.
We were definitely happy going in at half-time. They had done all the hurling. You know, and we still were only two points down. We were still in with a great chance, but it was different than other years in that, you know, we hadn't really settled. You know, they dragged us everywhere. We had no real shape to our backs or anything like that, and that's what they wanted. You know, they were dragging our half back line all over the place to disturb E, as well as the full back line. But you know, they had a game plan and it worked a treat for them.
And away it comes back up to the forwards again, brilliantly caught by McGrath on to Larkin. Stop Mark Corbin, who's in for a second goal, one after 10 minutes, another after 42.
The forward's job is to finish, or forward's job is to get the ball and try and score goals. But when you see the pass that Noel McGrath gave that day for the second goal, the pass was unbelievable. I wasn't too sure, did he actually see me making the run, but I said I'd make it anyway, because when Noel sees a person, he'd give you, put it on the plate for you, and that day he put it on the plate for me.
And it's Tipperary who lead the final. 2-11 to 1-10.
The younger fellas are nearly the backbone of the team now. They're driving us on, they're coming on. So we're kind of rolling in behind them, which is probably a good thing too.
No, these fellas don't have to say an awful lot, but you know yourself, when you see them bursting out and the whole lot going with it,
yeah,
it gives you huge energy and motivation.
Exactly, yeah.
From inside his own 65 metres, he fires it in, they race for it, breaking down here. Tipperary! 2 minutes after Lord Corbett's second goal, Noel McGrath is on hand to steer it in past PJ Ryan.
We knew we had 5 or 6 fellas on the bench to come out that would make a difference. So you played to exhaustion and then you gave the baton on to someone else to come in.
Yeah.
Who knows how this one is going to go, as Seamus Callanan introduces himself by putting it over the bar.
Like I said earlier, when Shamie Cannon and Fez came on, you know, and Benny came on, then Benny got the point, you know what I mean, as well. And there's a real transformation, a great show of character from Benny to do that. And that gave us all energy and fueled us. Like.
Definitely, like, and I suppose the lift that he gave the whole team, I suppose, and Benny coming on after 2009 and me slotting that ball over the bar in 2010, like, we could already feel Benny's emotion when that point was going over the bar, you know, which is great for him too.
David Young wins this one. To keep it away from Michael Fennelly. He slips it in there. Once again, they hold the possession, and Benny Dunn sees it drop over the crossbar. What a difference 12 months can make to a team and to a player.
They brought on subs that day that were scoring points from all angles, and it was really, I suppose, a panel effort. And I just think they out-hurled us more than that on the day, and that was probably the most disappointing thing from our point of view.
Certain parts of that game, where I just felt that they wanted more. I think Seamus Cannon in the second half chased down, I think Eddie Brennan up in the far corner and cleared the ball and things like that. But I felt like it was slipping away, and then when the goals came, they were like nails in the coffin, really.
As that ball is caught inside there by Patrick Maher, and it's swept in the end, and it's finished in the back of the net. And there is another one for Tipperary and for Liam Sheedy. And Lark Corbett has got a hat-trick in the 73rd minute. This is how he finished it off. Maher played it to him, and Lark Corbett with three.
You had Bonner Maher getting the ball at the edge of the square. It was a hand pass out again. Like, you know, he'd all the hard work done again. My job was just to take on the goalie and finish. That's my job. But definitely, I'd give the respect and give the credit to the boys to give the ball out.
The finishing was unbelievable, like, I have to say about that, because I know above in training, like I've said in the past, when you come through, I'm going for the puck and out early, nearly, you know, to be fair. Because we do need somebody when gets into that, when the pressure is highest, to finish it. And I remember you went in as close as you could on each occasion to bury it. There was going to be no mistake.
It's all a superb, fantastic display by Liam Sheedy's team, and the five in a row has been banished once again. It has proved to be a target too great for Kilkenny, as it was for Kerry back in 1982. Brian Cody, magnificent manager that he is, he has lost an All-Ireland final here in what was his 10th time to take a team to the final.
Full-time whistle in that final at 2010, I remember just dropping to my knees after, because when you got the last goal, I hadn't really looked at the scoreboard. I didn't realise we're that far ahead.
First and foremost, I felt that we were beaten by the better team. Tip had played brilliantly in the 2009 final, and they played above themselves again in 2010. They were absolutely magnificent. So it feels like the end of the world, but it's not like that, you know, but that's what it feels like on the field at the time.
And I looked around the stand and see Tipperary people, like a lot of people crying and stuff too, you know. It was just a very emotional couple of seconds after that full-time whistle.
Losing the final at the final whistle was just devastating, because we're after winning for 4 years. That final was hugely disappointing, and especially the fact that I think we were just out hurled on the day.
People be coming up saying, yo, it's nothing and hard luck and this and the other, but, you know, it's no consolation. Standing there in Croke Park is a very lonely place after losing all there.
Very few people rated their chances. It was all about the drive for five.
I remember looking at the Kerry golden years, and they lost the five in a row, and it was just very disappointing looking at that, and you'd be saying, it's a pity they didn't win one more match just to do the five. And I suppose when we nearly did it then, like, it just wasn't the same. I'd never thought of it as a five in a row. I think on the day we were just beating the better team.
I remember saying to myself after the final, I said, don't get too excited now, just take it all in and see exactly what's happening. Have a look around the stand, have a look around the field. And it's just fantastic to see, like, exactly what the GAA and what hurling means to people, and hurling people, what it actually means.
I always remember Liam Sheedy saying in the dressing room afterwards, if we bottle this hurt and use it for next year, that, you know, we could go back and win the All-Ireland again. And I suppose that always struck a chord with me.
For me, one of the highlights of the day, I must say, was seeing Mick Gaiman and Liam above holding the cup. Yeah. It was like a drug working with these fellas. Yeah. Like, you just wanted to get training every night. If we could train every night a week with Eamon O'Shea, we would have, wouldn't we?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
You know, to be fair.
People forgot about the recession, I think, for 3 months as well. So it was gone mad. And I suppose it's just memories that you'll have, just say, for years to come.
The Premier County are the top county in hurling for 2010.
In 2009, two titans clashed. The heavens rose to the sound of the ash. Kilkenny in search of four in a row, the challenge laid down by their greatest of foes. The game began in blistering fashion, no quarter given and full of passion. The chances for Tip came thick and fast. PJ stood firm in the heat of the blast.
Go, Johnson! What a stop!
Then Benny saw red for what we don't know. Tipperary refused to bow or let go. Then everything changed in the space of a minute. King Henry and Comfort scored to win it.
In for Cowperthwaite. It's in the back of the net.
Four in a row. What a marvellous feat. Yet again on the throne, the Cats took their seats.
It's Kilkenny who are the All-Ireland champions for 2009.
1 year later in 2010, the two came together to clash once again. At the altar of greatness stood the amber and black. The drive for five was firmly on track. Until King Henry went off with his knee, Tipperary hurled on with incredible spree. Young Richie reduced the gap at the break.
Oh, what a goal!
A wonderful goal, a game it did make. But Larry and Noel were finally in tune. Lar with his second, the third followed soon.
And there is another one for Tipperary.
When the fourth goal went in, Lar with his third, a roar from Torres and Cashel was heard.
Tipperary have won the All-Ireland.
The champions were Tip, Kilkenny they beat. No victory could ever have tasted so sweet. So it's 2011 and they meet once more. Kilkenny and Tip to settle a score. More passion and tension and dramatic suspense. A game for the ages. Let battle commence.
Tipperary, I think, at all times were expected and very, very confidently expected to get to the All-Ireland final. So people would have had them certainty to be in the All-Ireland final. Ourselves, we wouldn't have been certain to get to the final in most people's heads. But our own ambition to get there was massive. And, you know, certainly it was all we would have targeted the whole time, and it would have been very much in the players' heads in a massive way, the hunger to get back there again.
It was a huge role reversal, wasn't it? Suddenly all the pressure looked like it was on us. Kilkenny down here, everyone would have said, oh, right, got up to make up the numbers. And I don't know about this Kilkenny team, but they finished, all the usual kind of rubbish talk was starting. And as a player, that's all you want to hear, really, isn't it, to motivate you. So Kilkenny had that.
The rivalry was at tipping point at this stage. You know, we'd 1-1, they'd 1-1. This is kind of deciding, you know, game, really. And, you know, for a lot of Tipperary and Kilkenny people, you know, they were all coming to this game, and whoever wins this is kind of, you know, going to be the real champion.
Just listen to the cheer. Kilkenny won by 5 points in 2009, Tip by eight last September. And many are now seeing this final as a decider in a best of three.
I don't see we were any more anxious or nervous going into it. We weren't any more confident, certainly. We had a great hunger like we always had, yeah. You know. What happened on the day was it didn't really happen for us, I would say.
I certainly felt that we were going to go out and we were going to play very well. I felt we were definitely going to perform. Whether that was going to bring a success or not, you can never be sure of that.
We didn't really mind going in as favourites. We didn't mind the situation. We knew we were going to Crow Park. We were going up to do a job. We'd done it last year. We were going to try and do it again. It just didn't happen for us on the day.
I definitely think Tipperary showed all the signs all year that they were well up for the battle, and it showed in the Munster final. But I think, I suppose, in the semi-final against Dublin, I suppose Dublin really put it up to them, and they barely got over the line. And I suppose that gave us, I suppose, great confidence that maybe Tipperary, that we could beat them, you know.
Definitely the Tipperary supporter, they give you a little bit better chance than what you might think that you should be entitled to. That maybe did we listen to it a small little bit? Maybe, I don't know, was we were trying to keep our feet on the ground, and I would believe our feet were on the ground, but maybe we're a little bit confident.
The Kilkenny supporters were just unbelievable coming up to this final, in the fact that, like, you barely even know that the All-Ireland final, I remember that's why I was saying to people, you barely know that the All-Ireland final was coming up. I think people just said that they'd leave us alone and let us quietly get on our work, and it seemed like, looking back now, it must have been a huge help.
So will it be a blue and gold year, or will it be black and amber once again?
A lot of our supporters would have been very wary. They probably would have fancied Tipperary as well, so they were probably staying quiet as well. So it probably was a much more low-key build-up to the final this year.
It was just real concern, but I wonder, is the team maybe near an end or whatever? And all those things were going on in the background.
Huge 160 metres way down the park once again. Coming out to connect it, Owen Larkin has got a couple of possessions. Looks at the target, fires it over his left shoulder and puts it over the bar. First point to come from play. Second for Kilkenny, they've made a very good start.
We did start well, and there was a great sense, you know, you could feel from the sideline, I think, that, you know, we were doing very well. We were on top in the game, certainly, and I would say that we lost opportunities to get more scores, to give us a bit more breathing space in the game.
Again, Richie Hogan. angling this one beautifully in. Goalkeeper comes out, and it's on the line, and it's safe from going over the line. Paul Curran got it away. Up towards Larkin, will bounce neatly in front of him here. Causing a lot of problems, getting a lot of possession. That was a difficult one. Any of his colleagues to take, but it might work yet for Richie Hogan. Tries to make space for himself. Only got two goals in the first half of the semi-final. Fires this one beautifully over the bar. That's a lovely point. Slipping it back out towards Richie Power. Has a support player outside, but he doesn't need him. Hitting it off his left-hand side and putting it over the bar. What a start this is for the Cats.
I wouldn't say it was the start we were expecting, though. It was definitely the start we were hoping for, because to go 5 points up, we knew that Tipperary would probably come back at some stage, but we knew with that kind of a start that it was definitely to be no excuses, that it was definitely in our hands from then on. And I suppose them 5 points, I think we won by 5 in the end, so they were very, very important.
Yeah, they were, and I wasn't really expecting that start. I knew we were in a good shape and good form and good state of mind, really, but, you know, until the ball is running and 3:30 on All-Ireland Sunday, you don't actually know what way the game is going to go. I thought Tipperary would come at us more than us go at them.
Jackie Turrell fires it back again. Paul Curran's been busy. Hand pass to the middle of the field. It's deflected back by Eddie Brennan this time. Michael Cahill now finding it difficult to get it away. Helped by Paddy Stapleton. The entire Tipperary full-back line under pressure. What about that for a catch from Tommy Walsh? Wonderful athleticism to get it across here. Quick throw on the shoulders by Henry Shefflin, and decisively over the bar. A second point for Shefflin.
Just look at Tommy Walsh. Look at the bravery. He's not a big man flying through the air. And just watch his delivery then. A diagonal ball straight to Henry Shefflin. And two of the greatest players, I suppose, of all time, combining there for a great score.
We probably didn't realise that it was 5 points to nothing, because you're so much into the game and you just want to keep going. And we knew that was the way that the pattern of the games the previous 2 years had gone.
You don't want to start looking at the scoreboard. So, like, I wasn't really too worried with the 5 points and the scores. And I was just kind of worried about, you know, the next ball or the next couple of minutes, keeping it going. But as Tommy said, it was a great start and one that probably stood to us in the end.
The question is, we were very slow to start. I don't know, did we start?
No.
So it's just one of those games. You're waiting for maybe a goal, or you're waiting for something to happen. Just didn't happen on the day for us, and Kilkenny really took advantage of that, going 5-6 points up in the first 10-15 minutes.
We just seemed to be spilling balls. There was things happening all over. Stuff that we weren't normally doing was happening to us, you know, and we just, maybe the whole situation probably gotten us, you know, when they jumped us that quick. But we showed great character then, I think, even though we were flying not at full blast, to claw our way back into the game and still give ourselves a chance.
And then we just suddenly we got a terrific goal, which kind of lifted the whole team. You know, very, very strangely, I think Henry was involved in a sideline cut, which I would always advise Henry to stay well away from, because I don't think it's his forte at all, and he did what he's good at, he gave a short one.
Here comes Henry Shefflin from the line ball once again, inside towards Richie Hogan, trying to steal a march of the defence, getting it inside. Finally! Finally! His first ever championship goal! What a time to get it, 35 minutes into the contest!
Suddenly the opportunity arose, and Michael Finley, you know, very athletic player, he just timed his run magnificently, and Richie Hogan, I think, spotted him and gave a great pass, took it on the run, and suddenly the goal, and a goal that kind of lifted the whole team and lifted the supporters and gave us that bit of extra breathing space going in for half-time.
Again, it kind of showed how we weren't really that lit up or switched on the day that we let this bloody quick-line ball happen.
He's doing that all year, so I wasn't surprised to see him at the end of it. Celebration after that, and off that to be desired, all right, but that was a great call.
At half-time, when we went in, it was the same, similar. It was a very, very calm dressing room, and it was for us in the backs, like, you know, we spoke about, like, what can we do? We were still in it. We weren't going to get excited, and that's back down to the management again, that they gave us the belief going out that we could perform.
Certainly, I suppose, when you try to get going in the second half, having such a bad start, it does make it very, very difficult. Like, you know, we did have a big mountain to climb.
Our main thing was that was one half gone, here's the new half, and scoreline was 0-0 again, and let's push on. And Henry stuck in his leg there one stage in a clash ball and took a bad I suppose, Bill, but you know, that's when the ball is thrown in, like, if some lad's pulling the ball, some lad's sticking their feet, and he stuck in his foot and was able to take it, and he didn't go down, he stayed going and put it over the bar. That was a massive score.
This time it's Henry from the throw, taking it from Benny, taking it into his hands, and hitting it neatly over the bar. Missed a few chances in the first half, but he's now got 4 points, Henry Shefflin.
Yeah, that's a great score, George. Henry showing all his strength and, you know, great pick-up. Hurl broken off and didn't bother him, straight over the bar. Great score by Henry.
The goal opportunities were very, very few and far between, and that's really what it comes down to. I suppose after Pat Burke got his goal, everybody thought that we were going to drive on from that. It just never really happened.
Inside towards Lark Corbin. Lovely little hand pass. How will they finish here? What a good goal! Tipperary. Paul Burke has got it!
Certainly them when Kilkenny got their goal, like, you know, I was wondering then at that stage, like, what's going to happen next?
John O'Brien went up 4-8, comes out here as far as Tommy Welch once again, very clever use of possession, flicking it out to Michael Rice. Nothing hurried at all, everything's measured, and Colin Fennelly races forward, slips a little hand pass into a determined Eddie Brennan, off he goes, like he's running in Sherbourne Park. Hand pass across to Hogan, what a goal! Quite superb. That's hurling for you. Hurling of the very best.
You know, he got a ball. It was a great pass. I remember it vividly, I suppose, because he had started on his run and he took it in his stride. And the pace then was just exhilarating. You know, he just burned it up.
And I knew when that goal went in, you could see a few of the Tipperary lads' heads dropping and their body language wasn't great. You know, psychologically for them, that could have killed him off. But it was just a great move, you know, Tommy all working all the way up until Richie ended up in the back of the net.
I remember being rooted to the spot as it flew into the far top corner, you know, it was a great finish, you know, to be fair to him. And like I said at the start, Kilkenny got their chance, you know, and even though Richie, like, it was a difficult enough chance to be fair to him, but, I mean, he finished it like he'd been finishing all year.
When you're on the edge of the square, no matter what kind of a ball you get, Richie, like, you know, it's really only one place for any goalie. They're getting the ball on the plate and you're one-on-one, so it's very, very...
They're going to beat anything, like, you know, and when they do get the chance, to be fair to them, and they were creating those couple of chances where we weren't creating, like, you know, and when they did get the chance, obviously, they took it.
We picked Eddie with absolute confidence to go in there and play. And when he was picked right half forward, people were expecting he'd play corner forward, but his fitness levels were supreme in that, and he's always maintained a terrific level of fitness, you know, and obviously speed has been one of his fortes at all times. And the terrific thing about Eddie is he's never lost that pace, you know, he still maintains that pace. Probably himself and Henry are any two people who can boast that.
Tip need to hang in there, as you say. They've got to get a goal, they've got to get possession very, very quickly. It's Owen Larkin, and Owen Larkin puts it over the bar. His second point of the match. That is surely enough now for Kilkenny to win back the title. They may have lost it in the drive for five back in 2010, but in 2011, Kilkenny have been the better team in this final.
We needed another point to be sure of it. If we get one more score, I felt that was it, because we're into the last minute of the game. And, you know, it was a puck out from David, and Owen Larkin caught the ball, veered, just turned, tapped the ball over the bar, and that was it. There and then, we couldn't be beaten then, we couldn't be caught at that stage, because it was there, and that was the moment for me when I just said, yes.
And the referee has blown his whistle, and Kilkenny have won back the Liam McCarthy Cup. Kilkenny are the champions for 2011. Brian Cody has done it. His captain, Brian Hogan, has given the leadership on the park. It's been a wonderful team effort, and the emphasis has been on team this afternoon.
It was never about anything got to do with a legacy again for me. It was nothing to do with history and nothing to do with two out of three, even though you use all those things in build-ups and everything else. You know, we weren't favoured to win it, we weren't expected to win it, and, you know, there was real concern throughout the year about whether, you know, we would be good enough or able enough to come back and be successful at that level again. It meant so much to everybody to come back and to win the final again. It meant probably more because you know, there was uncertainty about us.
Since the final whistle had went, or 13 minutes in the All-Ireland the previous year had went, I'd been dreaming about maybe getting back and maybe trying to be involved and maybe playing and to be part of something so special. And as Brian has said there, like, I suppose there was so much, what meant so much to us this year was because I think people just thought we were gone.
Like, the first player I met was JJ, and just hugging each other there for a few minutes, and just, you know, you didn't want the moment in, like, because just stand there in the middle of Croke Park, win the All-Ireland, and then, as you were saying there, Jackie, you just jump around and you lose yourself for a few minutes, and you could probably jump all day there for the rest of the day, and that's what winning All-Ireland is all about, and that's what you train for, is that feeling, because you'd still remember this winter. Like Tipperary will remember beating us last year, we'll remember that moment and I suppose that half an hour after the game forever, because it was just absolutely brilliant.
The loneliest place in the world to be, Croke Park, 80,000 people looking at you when the final whistle goes, when you lose, all you want to do is get in off the field, you want to disappear. And I suppose that's what I felt anyway.
Losing the year before just makes it so sweeter. To win an All-Ireland is brilliant, but to lose to a team like Tipperary had done in 09 and come back and win in 10, and like we had this year, it just makes it so much sweeter, you know. And all the hurt of the year before, you know, it just seemed like this is the focal point of all that, and you've bottled it all, and now you can just release it, you know. We're All-Ireland champions.
And Kilkenny are the All-Ireland champions for the 33rd time.
Get your chance, half three, and that day in September, everything points towards that. If you can't perform on that day, it's tough luck. You live with the hurt of that then for the rest of your life, and that's the way it is. There's no second chances in our game.
It's true.
Then you're left to your own thoughts, and that's when it really kicks in, I think, you know, when you're away and there's silence and all you can hear in the background is the fan at the dressing room.
Yeah.
You know, and that's a gentle home, like, and you're going, oh, you know, I want it back, I want another chance, but
you just gone. It's gone, and
it's gone.
It's not coming back.
No, it's not.
Sense of elation, really, you know, it's you can't describe the feeling when you win an All-Ireland, you know, whether it's your first, second or third or whatever. It's just brilliant, and you just kind of lose control yourselves for maybe a minute or two and just that and goes. And but I'll always remember Larry Carver coming over to me to shake my hand after the match, and I was conscious of that, and I wanted to return the favour, and I suppose then just after that, it's just, you know, I suppose it was different than the first time we won an All-Ireland, and the supporters weren't on the field, and it was actually great being in the middle of the field, being able to jump around and dance with lads and hug lads for a couple of minutes and just, you know, just really just take it all in.
I think this one for me was probably the sweetest, and just for alone of the fact of, I suppose I'm 32 years of age and trying to recover from the second cruciate, you know, there's no point in me saying otherwise. To get back and to win the final was a special feeling for myself and for my family and everything like that, you know, so I was just delighted, to be honest.
This year's one is the one that I would put as the best one so far, because we were trying to do something very, very difficult, and there was the, you know, the whole sense of the league final display against Dublin. You know, a game we wanted to win, and we tried to win it, and we were just blown away in that game. And there was a real sense of, you know, is the team finished? And a real genuine sense of concern from, you know, our own supporters, and the supporters who would value the team massively, you know, and want the team to win so badly. And a fear that maybe the team was, our winning days were over to an extent. And this year's one, there was a real sense of wonder about the whole thing for everybody, and for it to come together so well and for such a display, it's without a shadow of a doubt the sweetest one of all.
Singing is already in the song before.